funding for Indian Pride is provided by the Seminole Tribe of Florida, the Forest County Potawatomi Tribe, National City, the Otto Bremer Foundation, and the members of Prairie Public.
On this episode of Indian Pride, we take the temperature and check the heartbeat of health and healing around Indian country. Hear why turtles should not dance out of the water. And tap our feet to the beat and music of some Métis fiddling. Hi, I'm Junie K. Randall, and welcome to Indian Pride. After years of diet and lifestyle changes for Indian people, it is no secret that health issues on Indian reservations are the number one concern for tribal leaders and healthcare professionals. Indian Pride poses the questions of health, healing, and the future for Indian nations and the impact of the federal government's commitment to their good health.
It's important that people see that we have the same concerns that they do, that we have concerns for the elder people, that we do have concerns for our youth, and that we do have concerns for the mentally and physically challenged people that live with us. And we're not immune to anything that goes on in the world, and we're able to talk about them. And I think through this, we're able to educate ourselves about some of the diseases that we face. For instance, diabetes is one of the major diseases that Native American. And yet we eat fried bread up like it's going out of style. But we don't educate ourselves as to the effects that the fried bread has upon the body of the Native American.
In the prevention of AIDS and HIV, we have been working closely with our young people. Our people are suffering, not only just among our Indian communities, but all over the world. And I had just made a trip down to Africa last year and became aware of so much that's going on there with AIDS. And we certainly don't want it to get to that proportion here. This is something that we have to get involved in. If we're going to save our young people from getting HIV and AIDS, we have got to be truthful with them. We've got to tell them everything we know, everything that we've learned.
Well, one aspect of Indian healthcare that I've tried to focus on is the issue of teen suicide. This is a very serious problem, and one of the things that I've discovered is when kids run into trouble and feel helpless and hopeless, in many cases, they don't have the same places to turn that other Americans do. Mental health services are not widely available on reservations. While we have a lot of challenges on Indian reservations to deal with, housing, healthcare, education, none is more urgent than reaching out to those young people who feel that they've lost all hope and who are talking and thinking about taking their lives. We need to change that and need to give them hope and offer them some help.
When I was told that I had a diabetes, it kind of hit me hard. I was in denial for a long time. Then I decided to see how I can be able to change ways to more or less control it. There is help through medication, take the right medication, and exercise, and walk, and lift weights. Sometimes it is hard, but you have to get up and do your best to go out there and exercise all the time. In the past, I seen my buddies get like amputation or lose eyesight. And I know I'm gonna get there one day, but I don't wanna push it too quick. Life is too good. When it comes to a disease like diabetes, it doesn't matter what position you hold, you're gonna have to do exercise or eat the right food.
When a sick person is brought before a group of medicine men, they relied on those men to actually look at the person and diagnose what it is, and they approach it from that level. And this is one of the things that we usually use. This is what is called a gourd. When this is used, they think it's just a instrument that's used for dancing and singing. But medicine men use this for actually throwing the sickness out. You gotta play this in a certain way. The other one is. The other one is. This sound goes right straight up to the heaven, and they try to bring the person out of the sickness, or at the same time, throw the sickness away from the person.
Quality health care is one of the most pressing issues facing Americans today. American Indian health and healing is no different. Cost of affordable health care is near a crisis. Today's guest is Dr. Charles Grimm, Director of Indian Health Service in Washington, D.C. He was appointed to his post by President Bush. Dr. Grimm is a proud enrolled member of the Cherokee Nation of Oklahoma. It's a real pleasure to welcome Dr. Charles Grimm to Indian Pride.
Thank you, Junie K. It's a pleasure and an honor for me to be with you today.
Thanks. Well, why don't we get started and have you share a little bit of the history of Indian Health Service, because it is the legal authority for the provisions of health care for American Indians and Alaska Natives. So we'll just start right there.
Okay. Let me tell you a little bit of the history about health care for Indians. It actually started out under the War Department. A lot of people don't know that. The U.S. troops were moving westward, Army doctors, physicians treated Indians that were close to some of the encampments, often with immunizations and other things like that. The first true legal authority that recognized that the government would assume a responsibility, though, for health care for Indians came in 1921, and it was called the Snyder Act. It was a very small piece of legislation compared to our current legislative authorities, and just gave the government both the responsibility and the authority to provide such sums as were necessary to take care of the health of American Indian and Alaska Native people. In 1976, though, a very landmark piece of legislation was passed, and in 1955, from 1921 to 1955, we were under the Department of Interior. In 1955, we were transferred to, at that time, Health Education and Welfare, and now called Health and Human Services. But in 1976, a landmark piece of legislation that more clearly defined what was expected from the government to American Indian and Alaska Native tribes was passed, and it was called the Indian Health Care Improvement Act. That bill is still our current authorization today. I said that first bill, the Snyder Act, was a couple of paragraphs. Our current legislative authority is over 300 pages long that directs our health programs, our facilities programs, and our environmental health programs.
Quite a document to have to worry about. Your administration is a multi-billion dollar healthcare delivery program composed of 12 administrative area regional offices throughout Indian country. How is the budget developed, and what factors are used to determine the outcome of this budget?
That's a very good question. Our appropriated budget from Congress is directly to the Indian Health Service is about $3.2 billion. We have several other pieces of money, including the ability to bill Medicare, Medicaid, and private insurance. When you factor that in, some special monies Congress made available for grants to Indian country, specifically for diabetes and diabetes prevention, our budget approaches $4 billion annually. The way we formulate that, and we have done so over the last six, seven, 8 years, as we started working locally with Indian country in our regions. We have 12 regions. We have each of our regional offices work with the tribes in that region to formulate their priorities for our budget. That is rolled up to a national level. We have tribal representatives that come from all over the country to this national meeting, and we debate the issues of what to ask Congress for each year. then we start working as the administration, myself and my staff. We put together the president's budget, and I would say a huge amount. We've looked historically over the years since we've started consulting with Indian Country on our budget like this. A huge percentage of what they've asked for at the local and national levels end up showing up in our budgets. We measure outcomes in numerous ways, but we are a very measurement-oriented organization. And there are different tools that the government has put upon us over time, something called the Government Performance and Results Act, where we report to Congress on many indicators of outcomes and processes within our system. We answer to the Office of Management and Budget with an instrument tool called the Program Assessment Rating Tool. And then we answer to many accrediting agencies through all the standards that they set out for hospitals and clinics. And we meet the same standards that private hospital sector clinics and hospitals meet. So we are measured in numerous ways, and we always do outstanding in all of the measurements that have ever been put before us.
Quickly, what is the largest budget item that really eats away at this budget?
The one that you hear the most about from people in Indian Country, and the one that I get the most letters from congressmen and senators about, is our contract health service budget. We have in excess of $500 million in that budget line item, and what that is used for is to pay for care that we cannot provide in our hospitals and clinics. As you are probably aware, having lived on or near one of our clinics, we only provide certain levels of care. Not every tribal location has a hospital. So if you just have an ambulatory clinic and we have to refer you out for hospital care of some sort, we use that contract health service budget to pay for that. And the reason we hear so much about that is that it's not sufficient to meet all the needs out there for all the types of care that we can't provide in our system.
How many Indian doctors or dentists and nurses do you employ at IHS, and do you have any special programs available to Indian Country to help enhance those programs?
About 70% of our entire workforce, and we have about 16,000 people that work for us directly at the Indian Health Service. That does not include the tribes and the programs that they manage. Of those 16,000 people, about 70% are American Indian or Alaska Native. But when you take out some of the professions, physicians, dentists, nurses, the number jumps up to about 88%. What that means is, even though we've increased significantly over the last 50 years, the number of Indian physicians, dentists, nurses, pharmacists, we still are lacking in numbers for those, and they simply aren't out there. We need to get more Indian kids into the professions, the health professions.
Because you're Indian, I'm sure you are very mindful of the wisdom and tribal traditions of the elders. What are some examples of traditional medicine and what value it brings to the healing process?
One of the things the Indian Health Service did a number of years ago was to recognize that Western medicine and traditional medicine can work and should work side by side. That's just being culturally sensitive to the population that you serve. And so we ask each of our facilities to work with the local tribe or tribes that they serve and honor, you know, what the wishes are of that local tribe. Some tribes want their traditional healers inside our clinics and want them to work side by side with our people. Others would prefer that it stay outside the clinic. Some of our clinics have even built rooms for traditional healers to be able to serve right side by side with our population. So it's something that we've recognized, we've embraced, and we think it improves the outcomes of care for the patient. The patients believe in it, and their families believe in it, and when you have traditional Western medicine practicing side by side with traditional healers from a local community, we've seen some very powerful things happen. We have some clinics that have herb gardens, you know, so that the healers that have the types of herbs available for them to use. We have clinics that have sweat lodges and things like that, you know, right on the ground so that members can, patients can use those. So And you see, it varies by location, as I said, because we want to do what the local tribe feels is best.
That's great. We're running out of time, so there's a couple more questions that I have to get by you. Why don't you give us a little update of the incidence of diabetes, which I know is awful in America and especially on Indian reservations.
It's devastating to our population. We have the highest rate of any ethnic group in the country. Our population dies almost 300% higher rates than the general U.S. population from diabetes. Of the 1.6 million people that we see, about 100,000 of them have diabetes, and we think there are a number more out there that don't know that they have it yet. The startling thing about that is that we're starting to see kids get diabetes now. What used to be a disease of adults only, and usually later adults, are now showing up in teens, and that's a very startling fact for us. We're working very hard on that right now and making a lot of headway.
We have just a few seconds left, and I would like for you to tell me briefly, what is telemedicine?
Telemedicine is a term you hear a lot about these days, and it's becoming more and more popular. And I think it's one of the ways the Indian Health Service is going to be able to take high-level sorts of care into some of the most rural parts of Indian country. It is the ability to use computers, if you will, or workstations that allow a rural isolated clinic to access specialists in an urban area. Sometimes they do telepsychiatry, and a psychiatrist in an urban location will be talking with a patient in the middle of a reservation that's hours away. You can send x-rays over telemedicine machines. You can do dermatology. You can do almost anything that you can think of. And we're working to create greater access in our clinics to telemedicine and to the specialists in the urban areas.
Dr. Grimm, thank you so much for joining us today. We're very proud of all that you've done for us in Indian Country.
Thank you, Junie K. It's a pleasure to be here.
A little boy was growing up in a village in a high ground in the swamps. And when I say high ground, it's kind of like hammocks. And here in South Florida, in the Everglades, pretty much of the flatlands gets underwater unless it's a dry season. So during the rainy season, there'd be a lot of water. So for that reason, the Indians, Seminole Indians, would find a high ground to build their villages on. So this was the scenery where this little boy was growing up with his mother. His mother told him not to go beyond the perimeters of the village. And when you tell a little boy, you might as well tell him to go beyond the perimeters, because he will, out of curiosity, he will take a step or two beyond the borders. So he would take a few steps out of the perimeters of the village, and then another day he would go farther and farther and farther. And then one day he just went way out there in the swamps. And when he did, he came up on another strip of high ground, and he went up on that high ground and stood on that high ground. And he sang this song.
Mi mi tafi, mi 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 ali. Mi mi tafi, mi 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 ali. Mimi tathi, mimi tathi, mimi ali.
When he sang this song, the turtles out in the slough, out in the swamp, heard him singing this song. And one by one, the turtles started sticking their heads out of the water. And he would sing this song again.
Mimi tathi, mimi mi ali. Mimi tathi, mimi mi ali.
And when he sang this song, more turtles started sticking their heads out. And eventually, they started coming out on the dry ground where the boy was standing. And they started dancing for him.
Mimi tathi, Pima-Maricopa, 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 Pima-Maricopa. Come on, turtles, and dance for me. Come out, turtles, and dance for me. Come out, turtles, come out, turtles, and dance for me. So he sang this song, and the turtles really liked it. And they all came out and started dancing for him. And all that time, he was watching the turtles watching, or the turtles, when they were dancing, he picked out the biggest, fattest one and took it home. And his mother cooked it for him for supper.
All around Indian country, we love music and have adopted many musical styles into our Indian cultures. Our musical guests today showcase their gifts on the fiddle and the bow. I'm honored to present Ryan Keplin on fiddle, John Keplin on guitar, and 12-year-old Gabe Brian on fiddle, proud enrolled members of the Turtle Mountain Band of Chippewa Indians in North Dakota.
Thank you.
like to thank all of my special guests today for sharing their gifts and talents with us. We invite you to join us next time as we present another great showcase of Indian pride. Whenever you get a chance, do something special for a child. Bye-bye for now. Funding for Indian Pride is provided by the Seminole Tribe of Florida, the Forest County Potawatomi Tribe, National City, the Otto Bremer Foundation, and the members of Prairie Public.